kind of had an opposite experience where I'm also from the South. I made a real conscious decision to not go back, to really lean into the reality and, to me, what feels like a really cool thing to already, you know, I already said, like, the first gift my daughter is getting, she's going to grow up in New York City. You know what I mean? Like, she's going to be a city kid and she's going to get the benefits of that, you know, in the global lens that that affords her. But this is also extraordinarily expensive and it's not easy. So to answer your question directly, Nicole, how did I kind of finance all of this? The short answer is in pieces. So again, let's go back. I froze eggs in 2018 out of pocket. So that was, and I'm just going to start putting numbers on it so people can run the tab. Keep in mind, these are older numbers, and keep in mind, it doesn't have to look this way. I didn't have a single employee benefit around it. Many people do now, like you said. I mean, I want to applaud you, Nicole. You didn't take your bow, but I have to believe that your journalism and your work on this issue prompted and at least correlated with the Washington Post's subsequent decision to include this as a benefit. And I think that's how change happens. Anyway, I never had that available to me. So I had to come out of pocket 15, 16 grand in 2018 to freeze the eggs. I also only did one egg retrieval. Now in retrospect, and I only got 10 eggs. What most fertility doctors will tell you is that if you want a kind of high probability of one live birth coming from this IVF process, you really would like to see closer to 20 frozen mature eggs, and still no guarantees, but that's really a number that they would like to see. And I didn't have that, but I ran out of money basically after that first retrieval at that time. So I had to kind of hold my breath and hope for the best. So fast forward, I'm 38 now. I did have a conversation, Nicole, with my doctor about doing another retrieval at the onset, again, to kind of pad my numbers, to get up to closer to that 20. I made a both financial and, frankly, just like you said, a physical and emotional decision. I just didn't want to do another retrieval. I didn't want to put my body through that at the time. I was really accelerating the growth of my career as well at that time, had a lot of different shows, had launched my podcast, had a lot of things going on. I said, I think that I want to kind of roll the dice, and it really truly was high risk. Roll the dice, see if I can get any genetically healthy embryos out of the 10 eggs I have already frozen. And if not, then I was prepared to move forward with another retrieval, but I wanted to see what that looked like. So with that said, I bought my two vials of sperm. At that time, I believe they were around $1,500 apiece. So now you're talking about another $3,000 invested in the sperm itself. Then you've got to create the embryos, right? These things don't happen by themselves in this IVF process. So I want to say the creation of the embryos might have been, at that time, $6,000 or $7,000, right? So this is the fertilization of my 10 eggs with the purchased sperm. Then you don't have to do this, but I chose to PGT test. So this is a version of, you know, chromosomal genetic testing. It does a few things, right? Number one, it gives you information about the quality of the embryo itself, the health of it. You also get the gender identity of each embryo. So for me, obviously, if I'd had, you know, a healthy boy embryo and that was my option, I would have ran towards it. But also, being a woman, knowing I'm about to go on this journey, at least at the onset, solo, and potentially indefinitely solo, I felt, again, competency. I felt I was more competent to try to raise a young Black girl into a Black woman than having the greater challenge for me to try to raise a young Black boy into a Black man without a man present in the home. So with those things said, now, you know, where are we? 25-ish? Closer to $30,000 invested. And then I got my genetic testing back, Nicole. I had two embryos created out of the 10 eggs. So that's statistically it's normal, but this is real life. So it felt kind of disappointing. Like, damn, only two embryos? And only one of them was genetically normal. My other embryo was what we call mosaic, which had a combination of abnormal cells and normal cells. And many clinics will not transfer that type of embryo. So I only had one embryo to try with. And so then you have to pay more money for your embryo transfer. Now, I wasn't ready to transfer when I created my embryos, Nicole. I still was, to your point, had kind of some more financial growth I wanted to achieve and just some more mental and emotional space that I needed to kind of create to really say I'm ready to do this. In this whole process, I also bought a home, and I'm not at all saying that's a prerequisite or any kind of requirement to do anything you want to do. But for me, it also was very important, probably for similar reasons that it was for you. And I think once I bought my condo in Harlem, it made me feel I had some real roots, some real stability from a household standpoint. And I had the audacity to think that I could really provide, you know, for this child in a solo capacity. I could really have a roof over my head and theirs, and that was important to me. So now I felt finally at 40. I turned 40 years old. I wanted to have a good time, took myself to the south of France, And then I came back and I said, okay, I'm ready to transfer this embryo. My one viable chromosomally normal embryo. And she was a girl.